Allow me to take you back in time to the year 2023, when this bridge did not exist. Imagine standing here, stranded, faced with the daunting task of crossing from this side to that side with no bridge or road available. How would you have done it? Or what do you think the locals here did to cross to the other side before the Mwache Bridge was opened to the public in 2024? Before I welcome you to this unforgettable journey across one of Kenya's most impressive feats of engineering, let me set the scene for you. We are going to cross this bridge, and while at it, we will let you in on its secrets. First, there is a need to show you how you can access this bridge. These are the three different paths to the bridge from the Mombasa direction, the Nairobi direction, and the Kwale direction via the Tunza Bridge. With no bridge or road available, crossing to the other side was both a struggle and a dangerous challenge. People and goods had to be ferried by boats. A simple 660-meter journey across this ocean to the other side could take hours, costing time, money, and sometimes lives. It cost an average of 50 Kenya shillings for a one-way trip to get from this side to this side. Depending on the strength of waves, accidents happened and boats capsized. Enter the year 2024. That experience is all behind us now, thanks to this impressive piece of engineering. As you proceed, some questions need answering. How was this bridge spanning over an ocean built? Who built it, and what was used to build it? Sometime in the year 2020, the Kenyan government, through the Kenya National Highways Authority, contracted Fujita Corporation, Mitsubishi Corporation's consortium to build the Mwache Bridge. Mwache Bridge is the shortest of the three bridges of this series, emanating from the Dongo Kundu Bypass. Here's the secret. This video will form a part of a series of four videos, all connected to the Dongo Kundu Bypass. Make sure to subscribe and become a member to never miss the other videos to be published. Join us on our quest to discover the secrets of the 700 meters Tunza Bridge, followed by the 1.4 kilometers Mteza Bridge, which is the most impressive of the three. To ensure that this bridge is going nowhere anytime soon, the foundation of this bridge was set as deep as 60 meters below the seabed. That is deeper than some of the most tallest buildings in Mombasa. The piles, pile caps, and piers made from reinforced concrete and steel were sunk deep enough to withstand the weight of traffic coming from the deck, as well as the unpredictable forces of the ocean beneath. Check out the photo on the screen to assist you with the understanding of what we are about to speak on. Now that we're down here, when you look past the fence on our right side, you can see the abutment just before the approach slab. Immediately after the approach slab, you'll notice that the bridge has a set of two piers under each pier cap between the first and second span guide. As the bridge progresses, it takes a different model and shape, with engineers preferring to use a set of three piers instead of two. The reason behind this is to make the bridge strong enough to withstand the unpredictable oceanic forces, including the force of gravity, the horizontal pressure gradient forces, Coriolis forces, and frictional forces. Now that we know of the engineering brilliance beneath our feet, it's time to find out of the brilliance above our feet. With the flow of traffic, you can immediately tell what this bridge has done for the people. Going from Mombasa County to Kwale County has certainly been made easier. In the past, people had to use the Likoni ferry to get to Kwale, as it was the only real option to get across from Mombasa town. The ferry channel was often overcrowded and slow. Today, you can easily use this route to go from Mombasa city center to Kunda or Kwale in under an hour. What used to take over 2 hours using the Likoni channel has now been reduced to less than an hour. The use of the bridge on this road is also faster and safer, changing the lives of people for generations. The bridge has renewed a sense of hope, with people moving to areas they once avoided. When talking of tourism, the ease of access to Kwale's beautiful beaches without the stress of missing flights or trains has made tourists flock the coastal parts of Kenya more. At the moment, tourism is booming, businesses are thriving, and people are discovering areas that were once overlooked. But as with any major construction, there has been an impact on the environment. Construction of this bridge has also had a noticeable effect on the local marine life. While we walk across, we notice the superstructure of this bridge has been well worked. The superstructure is part of the bridge above the pier cap, or simply the deck area, which is where we are currently walking. The bridge design incorporates water outlets to prevent flooding. Water collected here goes through these holes into these outlets to the ocean. It's a job well done. These water outlets are available on different sections to allow for quick removal of any water from the bridge. The aim of these outlets is to prevent the bridge from overflowing when it floods. You can also easily notice that there are hardly any wires or pipes cluttering our view. Everything has been kept sleek and functional. The bridge is silent. As we continue with our journey, we'll quickly notice that the entire bridge is lit by solar-powered streetlights. Kenya is serious about going green. The streetlights have been carefully bolted on the bridge with precision to reduce vandalism. The walkways or pedestrian pathways are also fitted with strong railroads to prevent users from toppling over and falling into the ocean. You will notice that there are some gaps on this bridge. These are called expansion gaps, which help the bridge maintain its shape while it's being used. The expansion gaps are assisted by the friction pile caps and the gaps between the span girders, which help the bridge expand and contract depending on the temperature and vibrations caused by movement on the bridge. The peaceful Indian Ocean going around this bridge, the bustling city of Mombasa from afar, and the mangrove vegetation are views worth coming across. It is in moments like this that I feel very proud to be a Kenyan. This has been an iconic walk on an iconic bridge. It is an experience like no other. Crossing this bridge takes roughly 6 to 10 minutes, depending on your speed. Walking across the Mwache Bridge feels like traveling through history and reliving the past experiences of crossing the Mtopa Bridge, Makupa Bridge, Nyali Bridge, and the other bridges which you can see through our channel. This bridge is a vital part of Mombasa and Kwale's past, present, and future. This bridge is not just about getting from point A to point B. It's about connecting communities, creating opportunities, and building a better future for everyone. As progress comes with a price, how much do you think it costs to build this bridge? I tried getting information on the cost of this bridge, but my attempts were not successful. If anyone knows how much it costs to build this specific bridge, please let us know in the comment section down below. As we approach the end of this bridge, I can't help but feel excited about what's next. But we are not done yet. There is more. Let's go under the bridge from this side to find out what's next. From the approach slab, let's go under the approach backfill and see what is under this bridge. From here, you get to see how the two opposite lanes of this bridge are adjacent to each other. The bridge looks more of a viaduct from this height than a bridge, with pier caps supporting the first parts of the bridge. Let's take a walk to find out what is on offer on this side. You'll quickly notice that from this end, the bridge has a lot of girder spans, which are largely supported by pier caps. To support the bridge on such a height, the foundations must have been so strong. Here are more water outlets attached to the deck of the bridge and the girders. The aim is to prevent the bridge from overflowing when it floods. After a couple of minutes, we come across the first span girder, where the piers start being used to support the bridge. Here is where the bridge starts elevating, hence needing more support. Unlike the Mombasa side of the bridge, two piers have been used to support the bridge as it progresses over the Indian Ocean. From where you stand, the ocean feels so therapeutic. Listening to the soothing, oceanic sound of waves makes everything feel beautiful and serene. Walking across the Mwache Bridge to publish this video has been an enjoyable thing to do. You should probably come try this. I am not sure why two piers have been used instead of three, but what I know is there must be many pile caps under each pier to ensure that the bridge survives the test of time. I have to say that the substructure of this bridge is well built. Ladies and gentlemen, as I earlier said, making these videos takes and needs a lot of resources, and here is where you come in. To keep bringing you these incredible stories and showcasing Kenya in all its glory, I need your help. If you have enjoyed this video, consider supporting the channel, buy me a coffee, send a donation through M-Pesa, or give me through Super Thanks. Every bit helps us continue this journey together. We need all assistance we can get. Let's make sure no story goes untold. And remember, this is just the first of the three bridges on the Dongokundu Bypass. So, subscribe, hit the notification bell, and stay tuned for the next adventure.